least you must know that I will not tell you that whatever is not the truth, because I am not here for any political gain or for commercial gain. No, sir. I am here for your own gain about genuine. If you want to gain, be genuine about it. Now see for yourself if this is the case or not. You can see with your naked eyes, these people have seen the Kundalini pulsing. You can see. It pulsates. When people touch my feet, in many cases, it pulsates. They have seen it. They are not all liars. Why should they lie? Nothing to gain. No money, first of all. That cut out. So, what is the other thing? This Kundalini rises, and you can see its rising, passes through all these chakras, and it stops at a place where you have a problem. For the other day, we had a very big man from somewhere who came to see me, and this Kundalini came up and was just pulsating near the lip, like that. And the whole, this part was pulsating like that. I mean, only that part. So the people asked him, are you all right? He said, yes, I'm all right. But do you have a liver problem? Yes, I have. How do you know? You can see, Kundalini itself is suggesting it's pulsing. So you have to correct the liver. You have to correct the whole being. There are so many problems, physical, mental, and emotional. So whatever may be the problem, I have sorted them out. All permutations and combinations have worked out now. Perhaps there is no permutation that now I can say that is not worked out. Except for one. That is the worst of all, is misidentification. If you carry on with misidentification, we cannot help. You must know that you must identify with yourself and with nothing else. Then only it works out. That is the only thing, is the misidentification with any answer. Ask for the truth, and truth will be given to you. But ask for the truth, not the truth that you have made as truth. Truth is as it is. You cannot make it. You cannot give it a form. You cannot say, this is the truth. No, it is what it is. You have to see it. You have to be that. You have to appreciate it. You have to become that. Look at people, how they pass remarks at Christ. Even person like Christ. You see, everybody has become so ego-oriented. I mean, they think they have a right to criticize everyone. Christ is a person about who cannot think. For such yogis, I cannot challenge this one. They are realized souls. When they start thinking about Christ, they become thoughtless. He is beyond thinking. How can you rationalize him and bring him to this level and put him to this level that you become a critic in the BBC? Asking questions. So how did you have your resurrection? How can you understand? What do you know about Brahma? What do you know about divine working? What do you understand? The style of greetings. This little human mind can only become a drop in the ocean. It cannot understand the ocean and its work. This is the thing we have to realize. And once we realize that we are a part of this ocean, we become the ocean ourselves. But this is not lecturing again and again. It is a happening. You start feeling others immediately. When you are a drop outside the ocean, you do not feel what other drops are there in the ocean. But once you jump into the ocean, you start seeing everyone in your hand, absolutely rationally, which can be understood. In the finger, all the chakras. Now this knowledge about Kundalini was not known even to the greatest sages, even to, I would say, to people like Narada. It was not known. It was not needed. The time has not come. You know, when, say, for example, electricity is not created, what is the use of telling them about the switches? They were relaxed souls, all right, they had vibrations, all right, but they didn't know that this is the chakras and they catch and these are the things that are missing and this, they did not. The time. Some of them are really jealous of the modern people. They think, what have these modern people done that they should get all this knowledge? That they waited is the main point. These people try to show off so much, all right, go ahead. They are fixed up as some officers, somewhere in charge of this and all, officers in charge. But they are not going to be the inheritors. For example, all these people like Indra and the gods who are in charge of the weather and all that are settled down very nicely on the right side of God, arranging things for you, like the caretaker of this building. But you are the people who are enjoying the fruits of it. What can we do? You wait it, you sort it, and if you get it, that's in your right. But this I do not do to pamper your ego away, please know that. Because you have to get it, you have to settle it. And the self-knowledge is the thing where you are just in the center, where neither you are in the ego nor in the superego, you are in the center. And the space is created on your forehead, in the samsara, if you say it, in the kundalini rising. The gap between this, so between the freeing gap, fills up through the kundalini rising, he goes up and opens this samsara, which we call as the feet. And there on the path, you enter into that subtle awareness of collective consciousness. But as soon as your kundalini crosses this chakra of agya, immediately you become thoughtlessly aware. Means you will be aware, but there won't be any thought, which is described by you. And what he has talked about, collective consciousness, from where we get the ideas and things, that is the portion you reach, means it becomes your own nature. It is an actualization, it is not talking. It is an actualization, your body becomes that. Like a human being, you become a superhuman. From an animal to a human being, there is definitely difference in awareness. In the same way, there is a difference in the awareness of a man and a superman, but the only exception is that in your own consciousness, you see it happen. It's the only human beings can see their evolution and not the animal. Because you have been given freedom to see it. But the way the freedom has been used, you can write volumes on that. So better not go into that. Let us forget about it. If he can do without going to the mistakes, if he can manage it, better do. But if the mistakes are there, we'll face them all. I'm with you throughout. Absolutely with you. And it should work out. Now, if we say that this is wrong, we should not do this, don't get angry. For example, the other day I told somebody that drinks and alcohol goes against sahaja. He got very angry with me. I said, do you own a shop? Why are you angry? I mean, it's a simple thing. I'm telling you. Should I tell you, you go and get drunk? Should I tell you, is it a good thing? You can do anything with yourself. Should I tell you? Now, you tell me one, in this whole world, where you have all kinds of morality, so-called, where is a man crowned for drinking? In the whole world, in the whole East, tell me, any man crowned for drinking, getting drunk, or a statue erected in it? Have you seen any? Have you seen any man being garlanded for being licentious and permissive? That means collectively human beings never accepted this kind of a norm. So far, I mean, I don't know, collectively everybody becomes a satan, then God alone knows. But even in the Roman Empire, when it was the worst of all at that time, it was not. So collectively human beings have always accepted holiness, righteousness as the great thing. And even till today, those people who lived in ordinary houses and huts are respected, and huge big properties are made in their name, because that name itself gives them that power. But they are misusing it. They are insulting them. They are actually hurting the souls of all these people. It's a tremendous boon. But what to do? Human beings do it for their self-check. They do it out of ignorance. If they do it out of ignorance, it will be forgiven. Everything will be forgiven. Take it from it, and you'll be amazed how it works out. Now, I would say, if you have any questions, you better ask me, because I still I have not been able to answer all your questions, despite I know what's working in your mind. So, any one of you have any questions, please ask me before we start the program. But not too much of it, because some are just there, and if we ask funny, foolish, stupid questions, we are going to divert their attention. We have not achieved it. We are not there. We are still nervous. We are nowhere. So please don't disturb others. That is important. If you are doing it only for the next day, everything you do it. Otherwise, you are just trying to show off. The other day somebody said, in this book this is written. Now, am I going to answer for all the books that are written? No. Actually, I am not even a graduate. How much is price studying? This is another knowledge I am talking about. So don't waste your energy and my energy and everybody's energy. And if you have come here to show off, I would request you go on. Because this is not to show off, but to show in. So that's one. Do not try to play with yourself. Again and again I request you. You have wasted a lot of your life in sin. And the time has come. Gregor says he was not the saint, but he is. You are a lot of sin. Otherwise you would not be there. You would be sitting in some discotheque. Or if not there, in some race course. Somewhere there. But when you are here, you are. These are the saints who have the right to get. But you have to be a saint. Means you should have seen of the right, real time. If you are real and genuine, it will happen and work out. I would like you to ask me questions if there is any explanation needed or anything which you think.
Today the vibrations are too many, Abhi. There's no need to talk. But as I was telling just now, Gavin, that your minds have a habit of talking all the time, so I have to speak to stop talking. Today most of us are here realized people and our daily people who come down and who have known a lot about Kundalini, have learnt a lot. Perhaps I do not know if you realize how much you have matured and how much you really know such a lot about Kundalini, about human beings, their chakras, how it catches, and about the divine power that is all pervading and so subtle. All these things have come to you so suddenly and as if you are open to it, suddenly you've got it and it's all dawned on you. So the whole thing looks like sudden awakening within and awareness that has enlarged suddenly, and you can feel everybody's vibrations, you can feel their chakras, you can raise their kundalini, you can give them realization. And some people who have been never able to speak a word about anything on a platform can now speak about it because the confidence has come through experience. Because you were just ready for it. In the sense that we are all built that way. Like suddenly we find in a tree, on a tree, lots of flowers appear, and then suddenly one day we find lots of fruits appear. In the same way it has happened to you, suddenly a flower becomes a fruit. And the fruit is not aware that it has become a fruit. And then he starts seeing that he's become a fruit, and he doesn't realize how much he has suddenly achieved as a fruit, as a matured personality. It is a very spontaneous inbuilt process which fulfills itself. But still some of you have been with Sahaja Yoga for quite some time, and naturally they know much more and they are much more deeply aware about many things, which all of you are not. And that's why if they are having this seminar, I hope you all take advantage of it. That will help you to do better justice to yourself and to your realization. It's a good chance you'll be there. I hope I'll be there as many days it is possible, but I'll be there. Today's subject is, which is not Kundalini so much, because I talked to you about Kundalini, but there are again new people today, and it's rather difficult to shift to another subject on which I was wanting to speak to you very much, and I don't know if I should really. Hello, Peggy, how are you?
I'm thankful to Bala and Philip and all my children who have been able to arrange this hall and have you all here for this program. Modern times are really very different from whatever times the incarnations came on this earth. There's such a tremendous difference when Christ came on this earth and today when somebody has to face the seekers. There were no seekers at the time of Christ, not a single seeker. When he came on this earth, he had to actually persuade people. He had to put some sort of an explanation for them that they should seek, that there is something beyond which they should ask. But today, it's a very different thing. Today we have seekers, and not one, but millions of them, especially in the West, people are seeking. The seeking comes to us through our capacity to conceive something beyond. We do not know why we are seeking, what we are seeking, but there's a craving within us which makes us feel uncomfortable all the time, despite the fact we have such a lot of affluence around us. I mean, as far as our food and our clothing and our housing questions are there, most of them are solved. Despite that, we feel that we have not been able to feel happy, joyous, and have not been able to understand our own fulfillment. We do not know why we are on this earth, why we have to be born as human beings. What is our mission in life? But there are so many who do not think about it. They are not bothered about it. For example, the scientists of the West do not think why they have become from amoeba a human being. Why God has made them from an amoeba, a little unicellular animal, into a human being? And why such a complicated instrument has been created? And how it has been created? What are the undercurrents? What are the powers that have created this wonderful thing known as a human being? They have not been able to find out the why of it. Of course, whatever they see, they can tell you that this is what a human being is, this is what he, this is his nose, and these are his eyes, and whatever factual things they find out, they tell you that this is what it is. But what is our destination? What is the purpose? And this is what they cannot answer, and that's why we have another type of people who are the seekers. But for your information, I have to tell you that God has already made all the arrangements for you. You have come up from amoeba stage to human beings. What did you do in your evolution? What effort did you put in for your evolution to become a human being? Just think of it. They say that you were monkeys and today you are human beings. What did you do? Do you remember what you have done to become human beings? Who has done all this? Somebody who has done with his own effort. And that is the same thing that will happen to you when you have to go further in your evolution. That force or that energy, or if you like it, I would say, the God Almighty who has created us is going to give us that special being, a birth within us. We are going to achieve that through His grace and through nobody else. Now, it is being said not only by me. What I say, I have a complete historical background. You can go up to Socrates and you can come up to Christ. Everywhere you will find what I say is written down there. I do not have to quarrel with them at all. They are my own, they are with me. But I am here to convince you that whatever they have said is the truth. Not by preaching, about it. Not by brainwashing, not by writing books about it, but by giving you the experience of your being, actualizing it, what they have said, that there is a spirit within us, and we have to be born of the spirit. And what is that spirit? Is, and how do we become that? That is what we are going to experience. As soon as I say, you cannot put in any effort about it, our ego gets challenged. How is it? It's difficult for a modern person to understand that God's grace is going to work. Even Shankaracharya, you know, Adi Shankaracharya, the one who propounded Hinduism in India, said that na yogena sankhena, not by any of these things that it is going to happen, but by Mother's grace it's going to work out that you are going to be realized. There's no way out, no way thinking about it, writing about it, preaching about it, talking about it. It has to happen to you. It's a living thing that has to happen to you. Like a little seed, it has to sprout. Now, no use standing before the seed and doing all kinds of asanas. No use giving a lecture to the seed. Just a little water of love and the seed sprouts by itself. It comes up by itself. And that's how your own seed is going to work out. The whole process of manifestation is spontaneous. But we think of effort because we are used to it. For everything we have to have effort. So we think even for realization we have to go into some kind of a terrible effort. But that's the wrong idea altogether. It is a spontaneous thing, it's a living process. You are made specially like this. Since you were a little animal called as amoeba, till today you are looked after, you are brought to this, and now you have to have it. How are we built within ourselves? And what is the speciality that brings forth this manifestation? We have to see about it. But when I'm talking to you, you need not sort of blindly follow that whatever I am saying to you. But you should not also close your minds about it. Because by saying it's not going to work out, it is going to work out by some other method. And when it works out within you, you yourself will know that it has happened. I will not have to give a certificate, you will yourself give a certificate about it. Now here I am going to tell you how we are built in within ourselves. As I have said, you should not close your minds about it. It is a hypothesis which you should see for yourself. If it works out, if you find that whatever I have said really works out and you can work it out and you can maneuver it and you can understand all the powers that are within you, then you just believe into it, then don't deny it. This picture, I don't know if all of you can see this picture, so can you come this side a little bit, sir? Just look this side, would be a good idea. There are some people coming down here. Some people. Yes. Those who are new people should come this side and the old can go that side. You see this. Yes, you can come this side. You see? Yes, please. Please. It's better. Yes, better that way. Yes. Please come this way. Yes. You can come here. Yes, come here. Can you see from there? All right, I'm happy. Bring forth rebirth or your self-realization. Already there is a mechanism made ready. We can say that as we have got this mechanism made ready here, in the same way there is a mechanism within us which is absolutely ready to act. We can say like a computer. A computer is being built in us. Only thing you have to be put to the mains, like this cord has to be put to the mains. That's the only thing now left. And if you have put in effort, I'll have to little bit, demolish that much of effort of yours. Because there is no effort needed. Only thing is, I have to take this rod and put it to the mains. But supposing I do not know how to do it, then I will spoil this. Or this by itself cannot do it. You can see a candle, and candle itself cannot light itself. But if there is an enlightened candle, it can enlighten that candle. In the same way, if there is somebody who is enlightened, can enlighten your candle if he knows how to do it. This knowledge has to come to you, and you have to get that enlightenment within you. Then you can do that enlightenment for others also. Like that you'll find there are at least here 25% people who know that, who have got realization. And why not the rest of them should get it? They should. That is their right. That is their birthright. And they must get it. Sahaja. Saha means with. Ja means born. It is born with you. It is within you. The right is within you to get it. And you all are meant for that. And you have to just get it for yourself. Now here is the instrument, I would say, placed like this. Out of which, if you see, the three, if somebody can show it here for me. Three energies that are flowing. Is one on the left hand side is black one, then another on the right hand side, and one in the center. Now these three energies give rise to three autonomous nervous systems within us. The left one gives rise to our left sympathetic, the right one to the right sympathetic, and the central one is the parasympathetic. These are the subtle energies play in the spinal cord, also in the cranial bones. Now these energies are, the left side gives us the existence by which we exist. By this energy we exist. But this also stores up our subconscious, or we can say stores up all that is conditioned within us. Because, say I'm telling you something, now you are listening to me, and all that you are listening is going into your subconscious. All that is stored up here. On the left, right hand side, the energy that is there is for our physical and mental activity. The left hand side is for our emotional activity, and the right-hand side is for our physical and mental activity. By this energy, we do our physical, any emergencies of physical activities, like if you have to run, you do hatha yogas, and you do all kinds of frantic things. Nowadays in London, we have a group of people who are dancing nude all the time. You see, all such things are done by this energy. The upper part of this this channel provides for our mental energy, by which we think, plan, and all that we think about the future. So we can say that this energy is for the future and that is for the past. The central one is for the present. Now you cannot be in the present for more than a second, even a split of a second. And that is what is the energy you have developed through your evolutionary process, by which now you have become a human being. Now, the whole system is left like this, with seven centers within you. You can see for yourself the red, the yellow, the green, the blue, the smoky, and the brilliant white, or you can say the goldenish, and the top one. Like that. There are seven centers. These are the subtle centers. All within you, placed within you. They are all there, already there. I don't have to create them. They are just ready and placed beautifully they are inside. And these, all these centers outside manifest what you call the plexuses. For example, the lower one manifests the pelvic plexus and then aortic plexus, then we have solar plexus. Theism has to take place. When these two activities, the emotional activity and your what you call the creative activities, start working together, as a byproduct, we accumulate in our head two things. One is called as the superego and another as the ego. We can say the smoke out of these activities accumulated there. So the ego and superego meet like this in the brain and it all fuses together and we get this spontaneous bone completely covered. When this happens, then you become Mr. X, you become Miss Y, and you become Master Z. You become different people, you get this I-ness within you. And you are separated from the whole. Like I can say, first of all, I separate this instrument and try it on its own battery. And then I put it to the mains. You have been given freedom by giving you this I-ness. You are free to do what you like with yourself. So you start speaking, you start thinking, you start a job, or every sort of enterprise in your life comes in. We have seeking for money. Those people do not have seeking for money, have got seeking for positions or for power. Some people, of course, have seeking for the divine. But in all these seekings, we go out like horns. We do not stay in. We seek it outside. We cannot take our attention inside. For example, when you are listening to me, if I say, take your attention inside, you can't. The attention is all out, has come out because of this kind of arrangement that is the brain. And if I tell you all about it, it is going to take another lecture. But how it comes out is also a very interesting thing. Only among human beings it is like that. Because our brain is like a prism. And because of that, the energies that come into us actually go very little inside. Most of them go out. That's why our attention is outside. Now, how can an attention be taken in? Say you are listening to me, all right? Now, suddenly, if something happens, it falls out. Or something happens within you, then your attention is immediately drawn to that. Though you are very attentive to me, still your attention will be drawn to that. In the same way, there has to be some sort of a happening within you. When that happening takes place, immediately your attention goes in. And the happening is done by a circular thing which is kept there, which are 3.5 coils. And that is the energy which we call as a residual energy, which is kept there like a coil. As I told you that you are to be put to the mains through a coil. And this one is called as the Kundalini, and this residual energy has to rise. And when it is awakened, and when it rises, it passes through all these centers and integrates you completely. And then you become one with the divine. You are opened out to the divine, and you find that both ego and super ego open out like that. And you enter into a new consciousness, into a new awareness by which you become collectively conscious. Now, this is a little bit too much to understand what is collective consciousness is. But as I would say that you must have heard all UN people and everybody saying we are all brothers and sisters and we should not fight with each other. But it is all outside. Hello. It is all outside to say that we are all brothers and sisters. We do not think that we are brothers and sisters. Or to say that this whole universe is one, we are all one, part of the one, and the whole primordial being is there and we are just part of it. How are we to believe it? It's all stories. But it happens to you that you start feeling the another person. On your fingers you start feeling the chakras. You see here I've shown you, when you are enlightened, you start feeling the centers on your fingers. You start feeling what are the problems of another person. You start feeling where is the imbalance in those energies. Which energy is more, which energy is less, how to raise it and how to put it down. Because you are open to the main, all the tension drops out. You become absolutely blissful. Supposing your car has got little petrol and it's about to finish, you your tension goes up. But if you know that there is a pipe which is all the time flowing into your car, which is filling that tank, then you are not bothered. In the same way, you get open to that all-pervading power, that grace, which is all the time filling you later on, and you feel absolutely blissful. The tensions go away. And you start feeling the another person, his chakras and her chakras, and you can correct them also. Now we have cured cancer, no doubt, and only this self-realization is going to cure cancer. Now this I have been saying from the year 1970. When they get cancer, they come to me, even doctors. They get cured. But when they say that Mataji has cured us, people just don't believe. It is too much for them to believe that cancer can be cured by self-realization. Now, what is cancer? It is nothing but overactivity of these two nadis, or these two channels. They are like this. This channel is, say, the right, this is the left. Now, this is the channel, these are the centers. When they start working too much, whatever is the stored little energy, you start using them. When you use them too much, they separate. And when they separate, they go on their own. Once they are on their own, then they become malignant. With Sahaja Yoga, what do? Is to pour that energy more into them so that they again come back to the normal state. And when the energy is sufficiently flowing in, there is no exhaustion at all. And a person feels perfect yoga. But if you say this to anyone else but a Sahaja Yogi, they don't believe. I did my medicine because I had to talk to doctors, and I will be talking to doctors now in England, London, when I come back from India. And that's why I did my medicine. And I find that my professor who was teaching me, his wife got cancer. And she had a secondary cancer. And then his wife said, why not try her? After all, you people cannot cure me. And they said that it's a secondary stage. It's horrible. You just can't say about the patient. Not that she's cured, but there is no trace of it. And the doctor cannot explain how it has happened. I can explain to him absolutely, scientifically, that we have managed the parasympathetic nervous system, which they call as autonomous. They say it is run by itself, by auto. Now, who is this auto? You say it is a automobile, all right. There's somebody sitting and running it, isn't it? But who is running this? This you cannot explain. Doctors say we do not know. The mode of action we cannot say. How it works we do not know. They are truthful about it. But when I say you can jump onto it, you can just control that parasympathetic, they say how can that be possible? It is possible. Believe me, it is possible. It has to be. After all, if some instrument has been made with such care for years together, for thousands of years, do you think it is just a wasteful activity of God? That he could not do something about it? That he will not give you your fulfillment? How is it possible? Any rational person can understand this. Through rationality, you can understand all these things. But the happening is for change, is a living process, and works out by itself. Now, there are some people I've seen that in seeking, they have gone to wrong places. They have been hurt. They have been troubled. They have been tortured. They have been misled. But doesn't matter. It is a living process, and living process is very different from a dead process. For example, something goes wrong with a hall. Then you cannot do something about the foundation. But if a tree is, say, in a mess, you can treat the tree in such a way that the whole tree can be all right, the roots can be all right. In the same way, this being absolutely a living process, everything can be all right and has to work. Now, but the biggest problem of the West is Mr. EGO, which is colossal sometimes. And it's very difficult for people to understand that they cannot pay for God. They cannot purchase it. You cannot. Maybe in your churches people take money and live like parasites. But God is not a parasite. These are horrible things. Maybe in your temples, maybe in your mosques, maybe anywhere, people are purchasing God. But that's a myth. That's absolutely a myth, an insult of God. Nobody can purchase God, nor can you have a sale of His grace and love. So, this is a big challenge, and people don't want to accept it. And so many thugs who have come from India, I take the responsibility as an Indian, if you call me an Indian, that, of course, they did come here to rob you. But you are also partly responsible. Your ego was satisfied when they said you can pay for that, that you were robbed by these horrible people. And if they have robbed you, they are going to be punished, no doubt. They are going to be punished. Because you are seekers, they have robbed you. It's a sad part of it. If you were ordinary people, they would not have bothered about it. But because you are seekers, they have harmed you deliberately and they have robbed you. If they are robbers, they should become, say, burglars. They could be good burglars. They can earn much more money by that. They should take to smuggling. But why trouble the seekers? It has happened with so many people. And so many that are here who have got realization also have gone through, not to one, but four or five of them, one after another. In America, people told me, Mother, we have been to go shopping. I said, now will you settle down somewhere or are you still shopping? They get into a mood of shopping, so they cannot stick on to it. It is a terrible thing. And that is the worst that has happened in the modern times. To awaken this kundalini, they say, is a very, very difficult thing. They say, I don't believe. It is not. It is the easiest thing for me. It's my place. I can just do it like this. I can raise your kundalini like this and you will also do the same. Once you are realized, you will also start moving others' kundalini. You can see for yourself that how the power of your spirit grows. You can raise their kundalini, you can cure them, you can understand what's wrong with their chakras, and you can look after all the people whom you want to pay attention to. You can do it too, because the time has come, the blossom time has come. It was difficult when only one flower was to flower. Then only three, four flowers came. Now it's a blossom time, so many have to become fruits, and many are changing fast. It has to be our master. It is working out that way. It has to work out. For many of them, otherwise the creation won't stay anymore there. Already the destruction has set in into our minds. This time the destruction is not going to come from outside but from within. Because we'll be frustrated that we have not been able to find out what we have been finding out. But people are of varied nature. Just now, Val asked me on the way, Mother, how is it? I am such a fortunate person that I should get it so easily. I haven't done anything about it and I get it. Because you are blessed, special. You are specially blessed. That's how you are going to get it. Now, in this Birmingham, I saw nothing but people and people and people, all kinds. But here, how many do we find? This is what it is. So, there is a choice and there is a selection. And there is a way of getting the right people at the right time. It can only work out with people who really deserve it to begin with. But gradually it works out in a very much bigger way and a very much bigger way. And many people can get it and can work it out. If you have any questions, you please ask me because it is such a vast subject that I don't know how will I cover up in one lecture. Tomorrow I'm going to be with Bala. Those who want to come and see me personally can come and see me there. I don't know his address, he will tell me. Tomorrow I'll be there till 12 o'clock. All of you are welcome to come and see me. But here also, if you have any questions, you must ask me. And also we'll try to work out the realization part of it.
Karma allowed it. And the grace of God allowed it.
All right. Now, karma is asked. It is also karma. Who does the karma? It is your ego. You do not do it. If you ask a tiger, he does not do any karma. We in our ignorance think that we are doing the karma. Because we have our ego there nicely placed and because we are something, that's why there is the karma. But supposing I remove the your ego from town, then who is doing the karma there? You are no more there. You go into a karma. Moreover, if I am something, say I am something, then I can cleanse it also. Possibility is there. All right? Do you know my name, Nirmala? What does that mean? It means purity. If I am anything of my name, I may be able to cleanse it completely. If I am your mother, I have to do it. That's my job. And I'll work hard. So don't you stick on to your karmas. Do not identify with them. They are nothing for me. I know how to cleanse all these very well. I have studied all the permutations and combinations of all this. All right? These people have also put ideas into your head that you have very bad karmas. Especially you see in the church to say you are a sinner, sinner morning till evening. Those who say are the greatest sinners, I can tell you this. And those who you receive from your confessions, I'm surprised they are not mad as yet. They should become, the way they are taking confessions from everybody. Just think of it. That's it. Human beings are the most beautiful things God has created. The most beautiful. You have done some mistakes, all right. But God is the ocean of forgiveness. Do you know this, what is an ocean? So do not worry on that point. Not only I, but you will raise the kutari and give them realization. All right? Some question coming into your mind, sir? Already the kundalini has risen very high up. When it crosses this point, you do not think it. You become into thoughtless awareness, vijjasamadhi. Already, even if you have to think of a question, you will have to assert a little pressure. That's the trick. Some questions?
They are just like you people, like the human beings are. You see how human beings live? They will go to the church and from the church direct to the pump. How do you explain that? You see, your own mother dies in the house and you have a champagne. Human beings are like that. In the same way, these are the ordinary human beings. They are not realized soul. A realized soul will never haunt anyone. So they try to be good, they try to be bad. They are half-hearted, half-baked people. So they are like that. But why take help from anybody else? Why not be yourself? You see, we do not like to take help from anyone normally. See, especially in the West, people do not think we should take any help from on my own. But why in spiritual life you want to take help from a spirit? You should not, because they are parasites. Once they get stuck onto you, it will be impossible to get rid of them. And then they start doing all kinds of tricks, you see. In my presence the other day, this, you remember Maria had come in our house, we had a program and they were all spiritualists there. And one of them got up suddenly and he started moving his hand like this. Now I said, what's all going on? He said, I cannot control it. I said, you better control. You say you are a spiritualist, so why not control your spirits? So it was going on like that. He cannot control. Hello, how are you? How are you? It's looking very different, you see, face today. So, these are the permutations and combinations of all the types there. But basically they are left and the right. But they can combine, as I told you. And they are hard. The sooner you get awakened to their cunningness and to their stupidity, better it is for you, because you are seekers. You are not seekers of this life only. You have been seeking for lives together. It has been said at the time of Nala and Damayanti, just imagine, at the time when it was Satyuga, just at the end of the Satyuga, you can say little at Dwapara, thousands of years back, it was said that you will be born like this. Because, you see, this Kali, this modern times, the one who is the Kali Yuga, as you call it, he's responsible for, you see, intriguing people against intrigue and confusing people. So he is the one who is the, which you should say, the driver of this Kali guys. So this Kali was once caught by Nala, because poor Nala was once intrigued by this Kali and was so much tortured that he gave up his own wife. Please sit down comfortably. He gave up his own wife, you see, and he was tortured. And this Kali was again caught up by Nala, and he said that, I'm going to now kill you. So, because you are the one who is an intriguer, who confuses people and who try to create all kinds of problems. Because, you see, there is going to be a Yuga in his name, Kali Yuga he knew, and that time everybody will be in a confusion. So, he told Nala that, you see, you wait for some time and I will tell you, explain to you what is my importance is, what is my Mahatma's importance is. Even you will realize my importance, then you will leave me. So he said, all right, you tell me. He said, you give me some time to explain to you. And then he told him that in the Kali Yuga, when I will be the driver of that Yuga, you see, the people who will be born will be the seekers who are today seeking. In those days, you see, Dwapara, in the long time back, are seeking in the caves and in the jungles and in the forest, who are seeking God, will be born as ordinary human beings, living as householders in very ordinary way, and they will get their realization. And that's why you should not try to kill me, because Kali Yuga has to come. If the confusion does not come in, people do not seek it that much, and that's why out of confusion only the light comes. So that stage had to reach, of that culminating point had to reach, and that only I can do it, so you just spare me. And he was spared. Now this is, when was this? Dwapara means at least 6,000 or 8,000 years back. This was the thing that had happened. 8,000 years back these things were said, or even earlier we can say, even before Rama's time would be about 9,000 years back. So this was said 9,000 years back, that you will be born. So you are seeking, and you have been seeking for many lives, not this life only. And now you have come to a point when you should get that, what you have been seeking. So just ask for that. Why ask for these rope tricks, you see? That vanishing tricks, rope tricks, all these tricks. Because this means all spirits. This is not your own spirit, the Atma is. And the English language has one confusion, is that the spirit is for everything. Spirit is your Atma, is the reflection of God within you in your heart. Spirit is also a dead body, and spirit is also what you sell in the pubs. So all these things confuse. You see, it's a confusion again. It's a very big confusion. But you must know that within your heart resides God. And once you become that power, then you become yourself. That is the self which is to be realized. That is to be achieved. And that you must ask for. All the rest of the things are useless. These are all outside. Even what is the asanas for? For having a good body, for what? All right, you should keep good health, I can understand. But all the time your attention is on your body. What are you going to do? Are you going to wrestle somewhere? Or are you going to join these, these boxing bouts? You are seekers. You are a different clan altogether. You are not one of these horrible people who take out the bone of their nose just to box each other. You are not those people. You are different. You cannot make jokers out of you. I mean, you are different people altogether, the flowers of the creation. How can you accept all these nonsensical things what others are doing? You cannot, you try, you will try it for a while and then to give it up. Because then you will not find what you have been seeking is the self, your own being within yourself. Now, how are you to believe into yourself also? How are you to know what is self-realization is? This is the point, because that is what one should know, what we should know when we are self-realized. First of all, it is all described in the scriptures, whether you take Bible, Quran or anything. But supposing you do not understand, but still, after self-realization, what should happen? When you realize yourself, means you have enlightenment. What happens when you get the light in this room? You start seeing everything. You start seeing yourself and you start seeing others. In the same way, when you get realization, self-realization, you should see yourself first. That means you should feel your chakras. You should feel them. Now you put your hands towards me, you can feel your own chakras. Whatever is scratching in you, you can feel it on your hands. You can feel the silence within you and you can feel it. If you are not feeling anything and cool breeze is coming, then your chakras are clear. That means you have seen yourself. After some time, you will be amazed that you will see within yourself the kundalini rising, putting its pressure here, going there. You can also see in others the same thing. You can say, where is the kundalini? When I ask, they say, Mother, it's here. Mother, it's not yet risen. Not that I don't know, of course I know, but I just ask you. And I show all the ignorance that is possible, that because I want you to learn and work it out. You see, so I say, oh, really, it's there? I didn't know, so I will. But I play an illusion by which you just don't, you hear me, but you don't believe in it. You see, so next time you do it very seriously. And I like it because then you learn this art. Otherwise, you see, you will say that, oh, Mother, you are doing everything, then why should we? So I want you to learn this art of kundalini fully, that you know about yourself, that you know about your own chakras. You find out where is the kundalini, how it is moving. Then you know about others. You know about others' chakras, where it is moving and how it is moving. So that you get into collective consciousness by which you know others and self-realization by which you know yourself. These two things happen. Now what happens thirdly? Thirdly, it should happen that you should feel that you are one with the divine. So there is no pressure in your mind, no tension, you feel relaxed. Now how do you feel you are one with the divine? Say for example, how do you feel it is connected? When it is passing the energy through it, isn't it? Now when you see the energy passing through you, you just say, it is going, it is coming. You don't say, I am giving it. You are the channel, but you never say that. You said, it is going, it is there, it is not there. You start thinking about the third person. You separate yourself from that and you start seeing it. It's going, it's not there. And moreover, you do not say that I am doing it. Neither you feel that you are doing it. So your ego is finished. You just say it's going. You cannot say, now, yesterday as we were working, doctor was there and these people, Gavin was there. They said, no, Mother, not yet. No, it's not done. No. They could not say that we are doing it. Neither they could say, yes, it is done. You cannot just say anything false. If it is done, it is done. If it is not done, it is not done. See, maybe your own son cannot get realization. Maybe a problem with that also. It is quite a possibility. So, it is the truth and it can happen to someone, may not happen to another. Truth is the truth. You cannot force it onto anyone. It has to get into a place and it has to work it out itself. Say, here is the light. Now, here is the light so you can see. But if there is no light in the other room, you cannot say there is light. You cannot force, you cannot give a certificate, a wrong certificate, there is light. You can see clearly there is no light, so you say, all right, there is no light. You are not attached to it. You cannot say that because he is my brother, oh, he must have the light. You cannot say that. Or you cannot say falsely also that there is light. Because you can see clearly, no, there is not, so there is not. So you are identified with truth, first of all, by self-realization. You are identified with truth. If you try to identify with truth, you cannot. You just cannot do it. Even if you try, you cannot. Because how can you do it? Because you can see for yourself, it is not working out, it's not going up, it's not happening. So how can you say? So first you are identified with truth. And truth is the nature of God. It's the nature of God. God is truth, which is expressed through your spirit, and the vibrations that you are getting is nothing but the pulsation. The spirit is speaking. Spirit is talking to you. There's a rapport between your awareness and that of the spirit. Actually, the spirit is giving you this light through you. You have become the lamp of the spirit now, and the light is enlightened. So you are identified with the spirit. You become the truth. Then the second point is that you have to become steady person. You have to be steady into it. Like, you see, believe into something, alright? Now, you know that this is yellow colored or this is white color. But, supposing somebody says, no, this is not white. This is black. You start wondering whether it is really white or black. Is it true or not? You see, see you are not sure about it. The surety of it is. The surety comes. Is it not? Sure. Even if you put 10 children together and tie their eyes and ask them to see the vibration of a particular person, all of them will raise the same finger. This. Everybody is catching on this. Everybody will say they are catching on this. Nobody will say that this is the other. So you get a sure and certain truth. The truth is a sure thing. There cannot be two truths. It has to be one. You understand this? So the truth that you see is absolutely the one truth. And what is the one truth is very simple, which is very difficult.